كلا إن الإنسان ليطغى.
Nay, but man doth transgress all bounds. Surah Al-Alaq, verse 6.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Reflections. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. And before that, he says something really incredible. الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who teaches with the pen. Now maybe someone would read this and think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs a pen to teach someone. And this is why we have to be very careful and make sure that we understand the Arabic language very well before we get into Tafsir al-Qur'an and also Aqidah. As mentioned by our scholars, for example, in the book Jawhar al-Tawheed or the Aqidah of Imam al-Dardir, rahimahullah, which are all taught in most of the classical schools here in Malaysia. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Allah says, عَلَّمَ الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ. The one who taught because or with the pen or due to the pen. What that means here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that He created those things that if we use them to acquire knowledge, acquire idraq and ma'rifah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless us. And we learn from this important verse that it's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who needs a pen to teach anyone, but that Allah created the pen to be used by us to acquire knowledge. Thus, anything that we can use, for example, an iPad, that we can use to acquire knowledge, insha'Allah ta'ala, is from the asbab which were created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our benefit, because we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever He does something, it's for the masalih of His ibad, to bring about good for His servants. So we take from this verse also the importance as Muslims in redefining, redeveloping, and constantly renewing our method of education, employing the best, most technological means, even in religious studies, right, in order to acquire the blessings of ilmu. Once I met a brother who converted to Islam, and he told me, I want to go and study and write on a piece of wood like the scholars did in the old days, and I don't want to use an iPad, this is a bid'ah, and this and this and this and so on and so forth. And I told him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ. Allah says, the one who taught with the pen, which means, masha'Allah, you should use all the available means at your disposal to learn and increase your knowledge. So alhamdulillah, there are a lot of apps out there that someone can use to memorize the Quran. There are computer programs that one can use to memorize the Quran. I remember in America, there was an uncle who used to play the Quran on his cassette player a long time ago. And mashallah, because of that, two of his sons became memorizers of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because their whole youth, when they used to play in the house, they would hear the Quran being recited, and over time, subhanallah, they memorized the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Recently, I was at the University of Malaysia, and I saw a number of students studying Sharia, and subhanallah, I was really happy to see that they were employing the most contemporary ways to study Islam. Also, I visited the International Islamic University, and the same thing, up-to-date, beautiful campus, incredible technological, you know, advances being made to assist and study Sharia and study Islam, also in other fields of education. And we take this from الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rest of the chapter, most ulama agree that it is sent in regards to one of the greatest enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Jahl. Now, the reason that he was given the name Abu Jahl, which means the father of ignorance, is because this form, Abu Mudaf and Jahl Mudafun Ilay, shows that this is what is his constant characteristic, Jahl. And anyone who would deny the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has to be an absolute Jahl. If he saw the Prophet in front of him and he saw the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and still he denied him. So Allah says, Kalla. Now, Kalla is very interesting because it's usually used to make ibtal lima qabalahu, to refute what came before it. But here, because of the personality of Abu Jahl and the severity of his evil and wickedness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does something that totally blew the Arabs' minds. He put kalla in front of the objects that it refutes. And this goes against the norm. And the reason that this is done in rhetoric is to show that the ideas and practices of Abu Jahl are so bad and so wicked that we can't wait for them to be mentioned. We have to refute them before they're even mentioned. And this is, subhanAllah, the secret why kalla comes before the thoughts and ideas of Abu Jahl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, kalla innal insana layatagha ar-ra'ahu istaghna. The scholars agree that al-insan here, as I said earlier, as mentioned by Imam al-Tabari, rahimahullah, is Abu Jahl. Maybe someone asks, how come constantly in the Quran we find that Allah never mentions the name of these people except in a few instances like tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tab? The reason for that is that the Quran wants to teach us to have proper adab, to have the proper adab, to be careful not to slander or backbite people. Even if it's the truth, except in specific situations, as noted by Imam An-Nawawi. For example, say someone wants to marry your friend, and you know the person that wants to marry your friend is a bad person. In that situation, it's wajib upon you to warn them of that person. Or if you're in a court of law and you're asked to be a witness, it's wajib on you to tell the truth. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to teach us the proper adab. So He says, kalla inna Aba Jahl. No, he says, kalla innal insana, and he doesn't mention his name. He doesn't mention his name. La yataga. Taga means that the person is extremely arrogant. Extremely arrogant. That to the point where they see that everyone around them needs them and they need no one else. And this is a very, very dangerous quality. And it's described in the next verse, Ar-ra'ahu istaghna, which means nay. Indeed, Abu Jahl, or anyone who follows the qualities of Abu Jahl, sees himself or has become extremely arrogant and rebellious, and because of that, he sees himself istighna, aw as mustaghni, that he does not need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-ra'ahu istaghna, he sees himself free of needs because of his tagha, because of his great arrogance. And this is a very dangerous disease, and that's why the scholars of Sufism used to say, oh Allah, make us rich by feeling impoverished to you, and do not make us impoverished by feeling rich of you. That the person has to have this iftiqar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this dangerous disease of Abu Jahl is rooted in kibr and arrogance. And the ulama said, based on the statement of the Prophet, that kibr is defined as two things: denying the truth and looking down on others. Denial of the truth was the quality of shaitan. Denying others or looking down on others because of how I'm dressed, how I look, my new cool phone, my new cool car, and so on and so forth. And that's why Al-Hasan Al-Basri used to say, I never left a room until I felt I was the one who is the lowest and most in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're watching Reflections with your brother Suhaib Webb. We'll be back inshallah after these short commercial messages. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. We'll be right back.